Hey guys, this is Tim from Tim's Electronics Lab and welcome back to another video. In this video I'm going to show you how to reverse engineer software located inside a device such as this Logitech Cortex controller. So take it apart and let's get started. So after you've taken everything apart, you're greeted with the insides of the thing. And you want to search for the microcontroller. It's probably really relatively easy to find. You can see it over here. What you need to check is that the actual part number is visible of the microcontroller. And this one is the NRF. So, NRF, and you also want to check for another chip that's relatively close to the microcontroller, and in this case that's this one. Now you want to search in the datasheet of the microcontroller if the microcontroller supports booting of an external E2 PROM. If it does, then this might be your best guess. So take a look at the part number of this chip, Google it, check what the part number is. And if that's an E2 PROM, then you've got a bingo. Desolder it very carefully, because we don't want to overheat damage or rip the thing apart, because we actually need to read from it later on. So be very careful. So after you've soldered some pretty long wires to your E2 PROM, it should look like this. Make sure that there are no shorts. And now you can continue by looking at the datasheet and finding out which pins are which. There is a generic pinout for SPI E2 PROMs, but you never know. Maybe it's not 5-volt compatible, all those things. So time to grab your Arduino and a whole load of resistors. And time to play around. So after you've connected everything to your Arduino, now this might look a little bit sketchy, but yeah, it's for one-time use, so make sure that there are no shorts. It's time to move onto the computer to upload the sketch. So after you've desoldered the EEPROM from your device, you need to open the datasheet. Now I've already downloaded it. Let me drag it to this screen. Yeah, sure. It's a 32K SPI bus serial EEPROM. And you need to look into the futures. And you will see a organization specification here. So 4096 times 8 bits. That's 32K in bits. But if you don't have that specification and you do know the size of the thing in bits, you need to divide that by 8. And please bear in mind that 32K is not 32,000K. It's 32,192, I think. So do a Google search or just calculate it. So that's one thing you need to keep in mind. And now we're going to the instruction set. You'll find the instruction set over here. You need to keep this open as we will need it later. You can calculate the ending address of the EEPROM, but it's listed in the datasheet for us, so we don't need to do that. Now keep in mind that the actual end address that you will see is not FFF but FF8, since if you go to the read sequence, the data is spit out by a byte at a time. So if we also read FFF, then we will read the first value in the E2 PROM, which is not what we want. So now we've got that information,
download the Git repo. I'll post a link in the description. And inside there, open the Winbond WW Prom Programmer with the Arduino IDE. Now, I already have it open. You need to fill in a couple of details. Here, the memory size in bytes. Of course, 32K divided by 8 is the memory size in bytes. Now, it was very fortunate for us that it was, where it is, listed in a datasheet over here. So we could immediately fit it in. And the bits per address. Now, you can make that up out of the read sequence. You see that there are 8 bits in the read sequence output. So you need to fill that in over here. If you look into the sketch, you see that it waits for the serial connection. If you just want to dump the data, you need to uncomment the read data over here, and then it will straight up dump it. It will dump 3 rows, the memory address, the hex value, and the ASCII value. But that is for use if you want to test it, but that's not for use for us anymore, because we don't have a file that contains the actual dump. Now, the function we're interested in is download ROM. If we go to that function, you'll see that the memory size has been filled in right here, and the address is very important. So if you look at here, fast read needs to be off. Well, actually, depending on your E2 PROM, SPI transfer read. Now, those are the commands defined over here. Read is defined as hex number 3. If you go to the read sequence, you can see that it's hex 3. And if we take a look at the read sequence again, you'll see that it's 16-bit addressing. Now, I think that's most commonly used, 16-bit addressing, since it's a very wide memory range. But if you happen to have something else, you need to adjust this, add another 8 bits to the address for 24 bits, or remove 8 bits for 8-bit addressing. And you can see over here how that's done. Then the read request is finished, and the actual data is printed onto the serial. So to actually use it, it's not that hard. You need to have a few things installed. First one is Python. So I run Python 3.8.2, and you also need to install PySerial. Now, I already have it, so that's really good. What you need to do is you type in Python download ROM, and then press enter. Make sure to open the Python script first to check the COM port used. You can find the COM port in the device manager. Then it opens. Then open the COM ports and you see Arduino Uno with the COM port. So type that in there. Here you can change the file if you want to change the file. So go back to the terminal. Python /./ download rom.py. Press enter. Now it waits for the Arduino to initialize. And if you want to dump the ROM, just press D and the ROM will be dumped. So D, enter, dumping ROM. And here you can see the address ranging. So it's dumping up till FFF, but 8 bits less, so FF8. And wait for it to finish. Shouldn't take that long. There you go. So if you now go back to the folder that the Python script was located in, you'll see a dump.rom that matches the size of your E2 PROM. Now, this is kilobytes, it's a capital B. Here, 4069 bytes. I think we can also, no, we can't see it in bits. So, what you need to do now is open OpenHXG. It's a binary hex viewer. I'll post the download link in the description. So go back to the dump ROM folder, the ROM dumper folder, however you call it, and basically just drag the dump.rom into HXD. So you can inspect the dump. Now you might want to change the width. Now it's using 16-bit width, but if you change it to 8, then it's each individual line is now a serial write from the Arduino. So that might be useful when you're debugging the thing. Although you should enable this line if you want to debug it. I think that's a little bit better. So now, what's interesting, let me change it back to 16. What's interesting is we know what device it is, but a clue that we actually got something right is this here, cordless controller, Logitech. So that's really interesting. So we know that we did something right, and basically that the E-square prompt is read. Now what's also interesting is that the last couple of bytes are just FF. That's also really good. So now we know that we there's a greater possibility of us having completely dumped the ROM, since my suspect is that most devices won't have the full 32K filled with actual ROM. If we go back to the 8 bits per row, you can see over here that it's it has dumped the ROM to FF8 and not to FFF, since that would print out this line again. So now we've got precisely the ROM, and that's basically just what we want. Now there's another tool that we need, and that's called Gidra. I'll post a link in the description, but let me open that. It disappeared, but it should appear. Oh, it's on the other screen. There you go. So new project, non-shared project, yeah, or shared project, doesn't really matter. EEPROM ROM dumper, and Logitech EEPROM, and enter the same project name. All right, so open it and import file, then go to that folder, ROM dumper, and select files, import ROM dump.rom. So now it's analyzing it, and when you come to this screen, you need to open the datasheet of your microcontroller, any 51 compatible microcontroller. Now go back to Gidra and raw binary. Please select a language, click the dots, type in 8051, and now you'll see a couple of processor and language variants. I suppose and advise you to just select the default, click OK. Now click OK again, and it will give you a summary of the ROM. So bytes, symbols, processor ID, Endian, and click OK. Okay, open dump.rom and click yes to analyze. Then in the analysis options, click analyze, and it will analyze the ROM. And if you scroll down, you'll now have the strings represented as a actual string. What you need to do now is press Ctrl A and make sure that all the code is selected. Then press the D knob on your keyboard. The D stands for decompile. Now it will decompile the whole program. We don't need the console view. We can make this a little bit smaller, so we can make this a little bit bigger. And as you can see, it it basically decompiles everything. So we've got a lot of lot of functions right now if you take a look at the function symbol tree. And depending on the ROM you're decompiling, there might or there might not be debugging symbols included. Now this one, there's no debugging symbols included, so the decompiler knows nothing about the ROM. So the first few things you want to do, come on, close everything, is open up the SFR, open it and grab your SFR table and rename all those registers to the ones matching in the SFR table. So the first few are correct. 3083 is the HP. Now 84 is not this one. Alright, so if we go back to SPI control, we can see that it writes a 1 to the SPI control register. So if we go SPI control, go to page 16. SPI control. Bit number, so it's writing a 1, so 10. SPI control 10, SPI connected to port P1 as for booting. So SPI, this means we can add a comment SPI connect to P1 and it's for as for booting. Okay. Now what's this function? Bad instruction. Okay. Ooh, there you go. Write volatile SPI data. Ooh. So EXIF, bit shift of 5. Now what's the EXIF? Hey, there we go. When the 8 bits are done, SPI ready interrupts, EXIF.5 goes active, and the 8 SDI bits may be read from the SPI data register. EXIF.5 must be cleared before starting another SPI transaction. So, this loop, this do while loop, waits until the transmission is done and then it reads the data. So answer is, so we can add a comment in here, wait for the data to be SPI data to be transmitted. Okay, so now we know that this function, which is non-existent, so we need to click here and create a function, is the function that transmits an SPI data block. So we can edit function SPI transmit read volatile SPI data. Not sure what this does, but this waits for the fifth bit to be 1. And I think that is, yeah, I think that this just calls or sets a 0xFF. Let's go to the radio function. So the radio register, let's search that radio. Ooh, this is quite interesting. The SPI control 10 connects the SPI to the radio. So if you go back to SPI control, SPI control, we've got, is this SPI? Yeah, this, we've got this one, SPI control 2. Oh, hey. 10 is 2. So this function initializes the SPI mode to for use with the radio edit function. So set up SPI radio. Now I'm not sure yet what this parameter is, as it's not really used. So we now have the function that changes the SPI mode from regular P1 to SPI radio. So this is, not sure why you want to have this again. But okay, fine. Let's see. Radio. We were looking at the radio register. Where is it? Radio. Because of course this is a wireless. Oh, there it is. Wireless controller. Radio. So radio 0. Go back to the datasheet. Radio. Yeah. Here we go. Radio port 2. Yeah, here you can see the radio port uses the address normally used by port P2. So that was Gidra who assigned the label P2. So that's good. Now we know we've got the same address. So SFR address radio register bit. All 0. So this just clears the radio, write volatile. Here's radio, write. So this is, oh, P0 alt PWM direction rec control. This, let's see, rec control, rec X control, rec X control. They gave us some typical sequences. Write, wait till not busy. So how do we know that it's not busy anymore? Let's see. We'll please also wait for before accessing clock control. Read, wait, yeah. rack control, the fourth bit, bit number 4. And control, yeah, 56, fourth bit, bits, the fourth bit. Bit 4 is only available on read and is used to the flag to interface unit as busy. So, this one waits until the RTC is not busy. Wait until RTC is not busy anymore. Okay, and now we see that 0D07 create function. Just switch create a function of it. Wait until not busy. Regex MSB, I think regex MSB, most significant part, LSB, so it sets FF, yes, FF00, regex control, 01, I think this is decimal, 01. 0101. 0101 writes to RTC latch register. So comment set write to RTC latch register. And here again, wait until the interface is not busy anymore. No. Need this one, comments, so pre-comments. RTC interface is not busy anymore. Okay. Yeah, sure. We know regex control 8. 8 writes to watchdog register, so this is the watchdog setup. Over here, comments, so pre-comments setup, watchdog. Cool, so now this is, what's this function actually? How's the function find now? The where again? Instruction info. Clear flow by parallel function. Throw call trees. Incoming call trees none. So there are outgoing calls. Yeah, there is one. One outgoing call. Okay. Okay. Oh. Hey. We came across, is that this one? Yeah, that's this one. We came across another thing, another function. Oh, and it's gone. Is this, yeah, this is the one. Oh, this is a really interesting function. From what I can see, is that this function reads the various ADC values. I think that there's a matrix being used to set the inputs of the various ADCs. As you can see, ADC read 1, read 2, 3, 4. There are 4 analog axes. Is that true? 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah. There are 4 analog axes. in this controller, the throttle, the jaw, the pitch, and the roll. So this is analog read and analog. I think there's also PEX. So this convert create function, and now edit function signature process analog axis. So process analog axis. And now find reference show call trees, outgoing, incoming calls. There are no incoming calls, so that's not true. Param 1, param 2, what's this? Ooh. Process and lock, where is the function? Process and lock axis. Param 1. Yeah, this sets the analog thing. What's this? Oh, this is the same function. So I think by now you've got an idea on how this whole system is working. And it's a lot of times you just need to keep going. There is no, it's not quick decompiling binary. It's not quick. It takes a lot of time and it takes a lot of patience. So getting the datasheet of your microcontroller is crucial. If you don't know what microcontroller is in it, or you don't have access to the datasheet, or you don't know what instruction set the microcontroller uses, your chances of successfully decompiling something of the program drop dramatically, almost to the point that I suggest not even trying it, because it's a waste of your time. So I hope you find this video interesting, and I'll leave a link to all the things I used in this video in the description. I'll also upload my dumped ROM, so you can play around with it, and maybe you'll find more interesting stuff than I do. So, yeah, thanks for watching this video. I hope you find it interesting. And I see you around very soon on my channel. Bye! Thanks for watching this video. I hope you've enjoyed it. If you did, please leave a like. Make sure to leave a comment down below. You can also share this video with your friends if you think they will like it too. See you next time.